If you're living in an apartment complex and there's a crisis, are you pretty much screwed? Hey guys, welcome back to the Dimcad channel. I'm originally also known as Dimcad. Okay, that's a question. I saw this in this question and this topic being addressed in a recent podcast. And I just want to jump into this topic because I think it's really important because so many Americans live in apartments. So many Americans live in urban areas. And the whole idea is, okay, if there's a breakdown in systems, and you call 911 and nobody shows up, you're basically on your own. The grid goes down, the power grid goes down, and you're pretty much in a situation where you have to support your own family. You're on your own completely. How are you going to survive if you're living in an apartment complex? Well, first it depends on what type of apartment complex. For example, you could be, I don't know if you're living in a 10-story, 50-unit apartment complex or 100-unit apartment complex, a massive structure where there's thousands of people around or hundreds of people in your building. I don't know if it's just a 4 or 8 unit structure that's just isolated. I don't know if it's in a densely populated area. A lot of people assume that, oh, if it's an apartment, it's in a densely populated area. That's not necessarily true. You can be in a rural area with a 12-story building, 12-story apartment complex with many, many units in a rural area. I've seen it. I've absolutely seen it. So that's definitely a possibility. Another thing is you could have like a 4-unit apartment or 8-unit or 6-unit apartment in an area that's relatively rural. That can happen. Or you could be in a 4 or 2-unit apartment building that's in an urban area. So it really depends on, one, how many people are around you, how many people are densely populated in that area, where are you on that in that building. For example, if it's a 12-story building and you're on the 8th level or whatever, the water system may not be that reliable. It may not be able to reliably get water up to your apartment complex if the power grid goes down, because a lot of times the water systems will rely on electronics, the pumps to actually pump the water up to a certain level. So that's something to keep in mind. Another thing is, will people just stay in their apartments or will people try to get out of the city? If you're in an urban area, you may be surprised that a lot of people, when they try to panic and get out of the city, they may actually abandon a lot of these apartment complexes. That could be an advantage or disadvantage. You have a situation where a lot of people or elderly people will not be able to leave. That's another thing, is who's in your apartment complex? That's another big question. It's not just how many people are around. Who's in your apartment complex? Do they have any resources? Do they have any abilities to help themselves? Because when you're dealing with large amounts of people, you're going to be dealing with a lot of people who aren't really prepared. And they find out that you are prepared, you could become a target. And that's a big concern. So survivability is definitely questionable if you're in a lot of these apartment type of complexes as well. But, you know, also if there's some sanitary issues as well, like I said, with the water, if people are in crisis and you got to... Is something going on next door as far as odors and things like that is going to affect your apartment. So you're going to be, when you're living in an apartment, you're limiting your options as far as emergency preparation. But realistically, we can't all necessarily get our own house with like 20 acres in the middle of nowhere. I mean, that's not always realistic for most people. But these are some things that are definitely worth considering. If you are in an apartment complex, you definitely can't just load up on a whole bunch of water, but I still think you need to have at least 1 month's worth of water. And you can do that in most apartment complexes. A lot of people talk about a lack of space. It's a matter of priorities. Like, what's a higher priority for you? You know, some useless items just for show, or maybe some things that you can actually really use. It doesn't have to be out on display like I have it. A lot of people say that it looked tacky the way I have it, and I agree, but I'm not worried about impressing anybody. For me, you know, just having some practical items is more important. Find something that works for you. You can have water jugs for water storage. I definitely recommend you have cases of water, at least 1 month supply. You should be thinking you're gonna need at least 2 or 3 gallons of water per day. And something you should be planning out. So something you should at least have for you. And if you have any loved ones in the area, you should probably have some extra water for them in case they end up at your house as well. You should really plan on that. Speaking of water, weight is going to be a really big deal here. So you want to have some type of water filtration unit. You could get a big Berkey water system, but again, you want to go as lightweight as possible. Canned goods is something that I've always got into, but When it comes to canned goods, again, when you move from one apartment to another, it's going to be a pain in the butt. As far as it lasting, well, you're better off with freeze-dried food. Before I even get into that, one thing I would definitely keep in mind, have plenty of flashlights, plenty of batteries. Matter of fact, have a lantern and a flashlight near your bed at night. So if the power goes out for whatever reason, there's a crisis, whatever, you gotta get up in the middle of the night, obviously you can grab your phone, use it as a flashlight. But a lot of you guys like the power on your phone to go down. That's why you wanna have some type of flashlight. Really good idea to have some type of battery operated radio. You can have a crank radio, but I find these just battery radios be a little bit more reliable. This is a short wave, so you get FM, AM, short wave, just a little more options. It's definitely not perfect, but a emergency weather radio, that's another option as well. But freeze-dried foods, definitely really good idea. Better than most options because it's lightweight, and if you gotta bug out, if you gotta go, you can just grab what you gotta grab and just get on out of here. If you live in a place like Michigan, well, I assume you already have a portable propane heater, something that has some safety features, so if it gets tipped over, it'll automatically shut off. That's something that this has right here. You want to have a good carbon monoxide detector as well. Anyway, you want to have that anyway. That's just something that's basic. Water, you don't need to overdo it. But these are some basic things that you should really, really consider. So basically, if you're in an apartment, are you pretty much out of luck? Well, you know, you're making some sacrifices here when you get into an apartment complex. But one of the things you can do, especially if it's a limited amount of people around, you can encourage your neighbors to take some steps when you're having conversations with them. You don't necessarily have to beat them over the head with a message of, oh man, the world's coming to an end or anything like that. I'm not saying that. That's not what we're saying. But what we can do is encourage one another. If you start a conversation with your neighbor or they start a conversation with you about inflation, you can mention that, oh yeah, the cost of water has been going up. The cost of bottled water has been going up. So if you plan on having some for emergencies or just in case, you might want to get some now because it's only going to get higher. It's probably going to get higher from this point on. That's a segue into talking about, okay, emergency preparation. You find out a lot by having these type of conversations, and you may find out that a lot of people I talk to, they have like one case of water, but how long is that one case gonna last you, especially if you have kids? Okay, so introducing the concept of, well, at least 1 gallon or two or three gallons per person per day and lasting about a month is something that's worthwhile. So that's one of the ways you sort of mitigate that. Some people talk about having a secondary location with emergency preparation gear. That's definitely an idea. You have some gear in your vehicle as well in case you're at work and something goes down. You want to have some resources. You want to have something that's going to help you. So these are some things that I really keep in mind. I don't think that, you know, if you're in an apartment complex, you're pretty much screwed. And we have to be careful with these messages of telling people that, oh, well, if you're in the city, if you're in an apartment complex, you got to get out of the city or you're not going to make it type of thing. Because, you know, I don't think that's really encouraging. I don't think it's really productive, because if that's your message, then it's going to be easier for people just to say, oh, well, the heck with it. You know, because, you know, you might actually discourage a lot of people. We might inadvertently make the situation a lot worse by discouraging people from preparing for emergencies, right? By setting this bar up, hey, you got to be out in the middle, you got to be in a rural area, you got to have your own place, your own house. I mean, if that's a goal for you, great. But I think we should encourage everybody, no matter what their situation is, to have, at least have more food, more water, stuff like that. That's something that we should be encouraging people across the board. So those are my thoughts on apartment dwellers who are in an emergency situation, and can they survive? Well, I'm not an expert, but I do think that the whole essence of emergency preparation is to give yourself some options. So taking some basic steps can definitely improve your odds, and that's really all we're trying to do here. We're not saying that, oh, if you live in an apartment, you're going to be just as good off as somebody who lives out in the rural area, has their own house or whatever. There's some risk that comes with living out in the rural areas as well, too. In cities, you're surrounded by more predators, But you're also surrounded by more people in general. So there's more good people as well, too. There's more people in general. More resources, more everything, right? But in rural areas, you're not surrounded by as many predators, but you don't have as many resources. And the few predators that are bad guys are around, they probably know more about you because everybody knows everybody's business in a small town. So that's sort of the downside to that. So something to keep in mind. So, all right, guys. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. And don't forget the future belongs to those who prepare for it today.